I teach at the Hogeschool Utrecht, a sort of Fachhochschule, and I mainly teach programming small microcontrollers and programming C++, either on small microcontrollers or on bigger systems. When I have to enter a description of myself, I mostly say software engineer by education and hardware tinker by passion. That's where my heart lies and that's where I earn my money. What I love is programming small microcontrollers. And yesterday there was someone who said, I program small chips, about 100 kilobytes of memory and sometimes 32 kilobytes. And I thought, oh, that's big. I program 4 kilobytes or sometimes, when it's really extreme, 20 bytes of memory. That's small. I hate repeating myself. I've programmed maybe the standard HD 447080 LCD interface 20 times and 20 different microcontrollers in 10 different languages, and it gets tedious. So I want to do it once and for all, and that's where C++ shines. But if you want to know more about how I try to do that, that was my last year's talk, so Google it. What I want to talk about today is next point. I'd love to use other ones' code. And there's an enormous amount of C++ code around that might be useful on small microcontrollers, but often in practice isn't. And that's what this talk is about. So if you're seasoned microcontroller programmers, maybe you shouldn't be here. I want to talk to the other ones, the ones who make code that I cannot use for good reason, but I'd like to use. We are on the second day of an embedded conference, so I'd like to shake you a little bit about meaning of words. The trouble with embedded is that it means very different things to very different people. It's clear, embedded means part of something larger and being a slave of something, being subservient to it, something, and not being generally programmable. But that does not imply a certain size of your hardware, or a certain capability of your hardware, or a certain way of programming. There are very different styles of programming within embedded systems, ranging from, almost using a soldering iron to program, to things that are indistinguishable from desktop or large systems. And often the computer hardware used for embedded systems is just the same as used in a large system. Often it is physically a PC put in some larger machine. But there's also the smaller part. There are some practical difficulties in economy of embedded products. When you sell an embedded product, the computer part is part of the product. It's part of the price. And when you sell embedded desktop software, you mostly sell software. The software is the price, and the client already has the desktop system, so you as a producer don't pay for it. So with an embedded system, when you pay for the hardware, there is pressure to make the hardware as small as possible. And whether that pressure is real or only in the mind of your manager, doesn't matter. There's always pressure to make things smaller, more compact, use less power or things like that. Often, the larger thing you are part of has to do things in the real world. It has to move robots or control airplane wing flaps or steer a rocket or whatever. And that has real-time requirements. And when things go wrong, the consequences are interesting. Maybe to a lawyer or to some post-mortem investigation team or something. The consequence can be very more severe than when something goes wrong on desktop. And that's also gives rise to different kind of programming techniques than you would use on some other systems. That's for embedded. On to real time. It's often also a confusing term. I try to define real time not as an all or nothing term, but as a continuum. And when you have a throughput-oriented system, you are more happy with increasing performance, and that relation is almost linear. And when you pay for the processing power of a batch system, you pay for each CPU cycle. And when it runs longer, you pay more. But there's no clear curve or no knee in it or whatever. When you program an interactive system, there is some point in between where the user notices that the system gets slower. When you're above that, well, when you're too much above it, he'll throw the system out of the window. When you're below that, the user doesn't notice when things get much faster. So there's a sort soft transition in how useful the system is. When you're in a hard real-time system, that transition gets very sharp. And my favorite example is a car airbag. When you hit another car, you want the airbag to blow up the moment your head is moving. If it's too early, you get a blow in the face. And then after it, you break your nose on the steering wheel. Or the other way around, when the airbag is too late, you first break your nose and then you are knocked unconscious. neither is a good idea. It can be a little bit like that, but the sharpness of the transition is the sign of a real-timeness of the system. It doesn't make sense to discuss whether a particular system is really real-time or not. It's a gradient. And there are nice terms, soft real-time and firm real-time. They mean slightly different things to different people, so when you discuss it, always make sure you agree on the term. The way I teach my students is soft real-time is when the usefulness degrades very rapidly beyond the deadline, like a TV image, you produce new frames. When a new frame is somewhat late, you get a hic in what you see. So the usefulness degrades, and when that doesn't happen too often, it's not a big problem. It's not much less useful if there was any use to begin with in those films. But there's also firm real time. The deadline is very sharp. If you think too long about your move, your red marker will fall and you're lost. So when the deadline approaches, you better do something. So a partial calculated result, use it. It's better than waiting longer to get the perfect result. Another term, mission critical, systems that have to work only once in their lifetime, like all kinds of military things, protection systems that are self-destructive, like the car airbag. It's also a characteristic of real-time systems that are often like this. Testing is difficult, and attention to every line of code that must be really correct is very high. The cost per line of code can be very high, and the cost of failing can also be very high. These were all very serious systems, but the range of embedded systems over seriousness is also staggering, from rockets to Mars or whatever, to little toys and greeting cards and room thermostats. And the way you program those things doesn't resemble how you program this. It shouldn't. That leads to a wide range of ways of programming. GBF is a typical Dutch approach of software programming. It's called Jan Boer de Fluitjes. It's to do something and see if it works and sell it. Well, I get one company has a testing strategy of going live. Customers will complain, and when they complain, you give them a voucher for something, and then they have a new problem report. It's a way of doing things, but it's not appropriate for this side of the continuum. But what I want to say is that when you're talking to a fellow embedded programmer, make sure what you're talking about. Your well-established development strategy may be very inappropriate for what he is doing. It's very different across the spectrum, much more different than most desktop or high-performance programming is. These are two talks from C++Con 2014. I really recommend about the kind of C++ they used in the Mars rover and in the, what is it? It's the GSF. Oh, the sheets will be on the website, so you can have it anyway. But they have a remarkably similar approach to what they want to see in C++ and what they don't want to use. That was Fields application. This is the hardware itself. That's also a very wide spectrum, right? From the very small chips for 8-byte microcontrollers with tens of bytes of RAM up to the big things that can easily outpace a desktop. It's all embedded, but it's strange to put it all in one word. You know, the small controllers, most of these things don't have a fully compliant C++ compiler. That gets to be here. Here you have just the normal compilers. But it's all called embedded. The kind of support you have on your chip, what can you run it before you start programming, operating systems, languages. Here you have the full desktop operating systems. In the middle, the real-time operating system-like things or the interpreted languages. And to the left of that, you're fully on your own. You have to write every instruction yourself. You better do that because only, let's say, 500 instructions will fit anyway. So that's very wide. And you program bare metal, use real-time, use a desktop-like system. Even microcontrollers itself. A microcontroller is a chip all in one. CPU, memory, peripherals in one chip. Back, not front. These right side are generally not microcontrollers. They are different chips for CPU, RAM, and flash. To the left side, it's mostly all in one chips. This is just the only one chip. Even within those, there's a wide variety. Price, number of I/O pins, two orders of magnitude. Speed, two orders of magnitude. Size of instruction. Oh, that's how many orders of magnitude? 8+. Size of RAM. 6 orders of magnitude. Word size, doesn't matter that much, but it doesn't tell the whole picture. So even when you're programming microcontrollers, you can be very different. What I mostly program is somewhere on this side, not that small, but these kind of things. Compare this with a desktop system. Here you see the factor of difference in word size or even clock speed. The difference is not that staggering, but in size of memory, it's tremendous, enormous. These smaller parts for the really smaller ones, and the quite probably the let's say the lower part chips will grow and the larger parts will get cheaper, but there, in my opinion, there will always be a niche for the very small chips. It's just that the applications they are used for will get more and more silly and, strange. There's no microcontroller in this pen, but in a few years it will. Don't know what it will do, but they'll find some application for it, maybe just blink a LED or something. Some people say, don't bother programming those small chips because they will disappear. They will get pushed away by the larger chips getting cheaper. That is true for a fixed application. If you have a fixed price, the chip you can buy for it will grow beyond imagination, but there will always be a market for the really small ones. That's a picture I show my students to tell them that small microcontrollers are everywhere. I would be surprised if each of you isn't carrying a few of them and your home is teeming with them. My favorite is, where is it? Ah, it's my son's dental brace. It has a chip in it. And when he goes back to the dentist, he can read out for how many hours each day he carried the brace in. And he is very, he wants to do it well. So he reaches, I think, 95% or something. My other son does not like it. I said before, when you make a product on a microcontroller, especially on a small microcontroller, the cost of the hardware is part of your product cost. So there's a pressure to make things smaller. You, as a manufacturer, pay the price, not the end user. Desktop users have it so easy. Just chip out the software, and if the customer finds it too slow, he must buy a larger system. He must buy it. When you program small microcontrollers, things are a bit different for you. Mostly your applications you're making are quite a bit smaller than desktop applications, often for very cheap things. Volumes can be very, very high, because in small volumes hardware is too cheap to make. Often you must meet some worst case timing constraints, contrary to a desktop, which mostly has to meet amortized average timing constraints. And often your requirements, what you must do, are more fixed in the sense that when you have a desktop and you're making a Word document, you like to be able to make a larger document when you have more RAM. And you will try even larger documents, and at some point it gets a bit slow or a bit tedious. Mostly for small embedded systems, it's not like that. You have a fixed mission, and you must have memory and CPU resources, etc. for that. And beyond that, it's not interesting what you can do more. It's very digit, almost like the sharp edge in the real-time graphs I showed. This is a survey of programming language used in embedded system. It's a bit pity they show languages used in a product, not number of lines used. So I cannot imagine assembly be used almost as often as C++, then not for almost as much lines. But a typical project will have some assembly lines, if only for a startup code or something like that. So if you ask which language do you use in your product, they will often answer assembly C++. So that's why that is very high. But you also see a lot of languages which we would expect on desktop-like systems. That not programming very small ones, but programming the big-sized ones. Especially when you see Perl, Python, LabVIEW, C#. I don't think that's hard real-time systems. Let's put that in perspective on the size of the systems. And to the left side, assembly dominate. For the very small ones, you cannot practically do anything else. For the larger ones, that's desktop-like programming. And there are a large part of the application there, but it is not real-time. But you don't care much how fast it executes. And you have plenty of memory. So all kinds of languages from desktop are valid here. C straddles the whole boundary, almost up to the left side. And what interests me as a programmer of small systems is the gap there in between. It's a place where C++ is not used much currently, but it has much potential. But most programmers there come from, let's say, the left side. And most programmers here have a background in electronics, EEs. And they get the circuit right, and then there's an afterthought, oh, there must also be some firmware. Programmers from the right side, they come from a desktop-like environment. They have computer science background. They know how to organize large programs. But there's an interesting part in between there. Okay, this is preaching for the choir here. Why should I use C++ for those kind of things? Well, as a better C, you can do everything what you can do in C, but you have less room for errors. That's always nice. It enables programming styles that are not possible in a C-like language, object-oriented, functional, template, using templates, using doing things at compile time instead of at runtime. And what I like, I don't want to repeat myself too often, there are more opportunities with C++ to write libraries in a style that can be efficiently reused, especially with templates and doing things at compile time. But okay, this would be for another conference. It would be for C programmers. But when you use C++ on such a small system, it's not like using it on a desktop. The applications you make are much smaller. Performance appreciation is very different. Heap, in most cases, no. Floating point, when you have a small microcontroller, it doesn't have a floating point unit. So the first moment you add two floating point numbers, it drops in the floating point library. It's a waste. Exceptions, debatable, but rather not. Operating system. Standard output, return values when you terminate the program, command line parameters, not applicable. As a consequence of those things, large part of the C++ standard library are not usable. They use the heap, use exception, use floating point. You don't want it. And most STL-like containers are optimized for amortized performance, for average performance. And what you need in a small system is worst case performance. That's a very different approach. And beyond that, they often use the heap, and you don't want to use the heap anyway. For your small system, ROM, program memory, is scarce, and RAM is even more scarce. So you want everything to be as small as possible. Standard outputs, standard inputs, often you don't have it unless you make it yourself in some way. Okay, those points one by one. These are techniques that are often less practical on desktop, but are very practical for small systems. You can compile your whole application as one compilation unit, include all the sorters, header-only programming, and compile it all at once. It's small anyway, so it's a big penalty. Link time optimization, devirtualization, the techniques to optimize your program as a whole. They don't scale that well for large applications, but they're perfect for small applications. It's a pity they're not used that much for large applications, so they are not debugged and developed that well, but for small systems, they're perfect. Oh, and you have to use libraries that are compiled without. Anyone knows what that flex means? When you have a normal library, everything is clumped together, and you link in the whole library, all or nothing. That's nice if we want fast linking, but it's very bad if you want just one chunk of it. So please, please, other people, compile. Performance appreciation is a bit different on a small system. Deadlines must be met, and being faster than the deadline is often not that good. Nobody cares. If you miss the deadline, it's okay. When you hear about desktop programming, you hear a lot about locality, code locality, and especially data locality, because you must work from the cache, otherwise you're much too slow. Well, the small systems generally don't have a cache. They have a uniform RAM. So techniques that are inappropriate on a desktop, linked lists, are very bad. But on the small system, it doesn't matter. Every piece of RAM is equally fast. Your algorithms should be optimized for for worst case performance, not for average performance. Locality is not an issue. Heap, well, no. Because what I want to do is fixed. I know at startup how much RAM I should need, what tasks I need to do. So maybe I allocate my things at startup from a heap-like thing, but then I never deallocate, and I never allocate at runtime while I'm doing things. So heap use, very limited or not at all. And nice techniques like hashing trees, rebalancing your trees, reallocating your memory. It's all tricks to make things perform well in the average case. But that's no use for a real-time, for a hard real-time system. You need the worst case. So a lot of those techniques are not applicable to small systems, or they are even harmful. You don't want your tree to be rebalanced in the middle of a time-critical operation. As I said, heap is a kind of flexible, in-depth response system. When your demand in your system increases a bit, you allocate somewhat more memory, and when it fails, well, you've done your best, and you inform the user that it failed, hopefully in a good way. But for a small, typical small embedded system, you have a very rigid requirement. You must need that. If you don't need it, well, get lost, you're useless. If you need it, it's okay. You don't need to need more. My airbag system doesn't have to be faster than in time. Real-time constraints. Yeah, even if a heap were not a problem for, let's say, knowing in advance whether an operation will fail or not, where allocation will fail or not, it's still a problem because after some time you have fragmentation on your heap, so you have enough memory but maybe not contiguous, and either your new or your free gets uncertain timing because you don't know how the fragmentation is, you don't know how the algorithm exactly works for that fragmentation, so you cannot predict your real-time performance. For that reason too, a heap is not very fitting to a small real-time embedded system. I keep all things together, so I'm try to be clear about in what size of the spectrum I am. What do you use on such system? Well, just global allocation, maybe. It's nice to know upfront at link time where your whole system will fit, and often that's that price is worth paying for the uncertainty. Yeah, you use a little bit more RAM, you cannot overlap the thing so that you need in different phases of your application, but you know in advance that it will work. And it will make you sleep very well when your software is in some rocket or something. Or you use fixed size pools or fixed size containers. And if need be, if you really need to calculate your sizes and don't know them at link time, you allocate only at startup. And maybe after that you disable the heap, so it gets an error to allocate things. Heap, floating point. It's a bit of the same thing. A floating point is something which is very useful when you don't know the range of your numbers in advance. It will adapt, whether you're calculating from 1 to 10 or from a million to 10 million, it's the same. But when you do know your approximate range in advance, you can use fixed point or integers or another approximation of that, and it doesn't lose you anything. Floating point is for people who are a bit more uncertain about what they will calculate with. And of course, if you have the hardware to do it, well, you might as well use floating point. You lose a few bits for the exponent, which you would otherwise use for precision, but that's not a big price. But on a small system, you don't want to drag in the extra floating point library. So what would I like to see when I see other people's code, which I want to use on my small system? Well, make your fantastic library open to what your value representation is, so I get to specify what it is. Defaulted to double, I don't care, but I plug in some integer or fixed point library or whatever. Exceptions. Exceptions are also a way to be flexible in how you handle your situation. in my my using word, I might get a user who is typing something for which I need to allocate a large chunk of memory. That might fail. Oh, the user is a bit disappointed, but he'll continue with something else. It's a flexible kind. I see at runtime where it will work. And if it doesn't work, okay, not much lost. That's not how an embedded system typically works. It has to work, or if it fails for a certain input, you like to know in advance. So on a typical embedded system, the notion of what is an exception is quite limited. What you would consider an exceptional situation is either fatal, the system stops working, or it's just not a normal situation. It has to be handled in a normal way. So then the exception mechanism is much less useful. And it doesn't help that most exception implementations use the heap. And we didn't have a heap anyway, so. Embedded programmers often use an argument that exceptions are slow and unpredictable, and therefore should not be used in embedded real-time systems. I think that's a strawman argument. In those cases, exceptions are still, well, not much worse than the alternative. But my argument is that you generally don't need an exception-like mechanism. When you have a certain situation, you handle it locally, and exceptions are for handling it somewhere else. That doesn't often occur. What do you do when you have exception-like things in an embedded system? Well, in most cases, you don't have an exception because everything you get from the outside world is just normal things. You must handle it. There's no exceptions. You must do your work. And an exception in the sense of something totally unexpected, what should not occur in your program. In test situation, you want to log that and investigate because it shouldn't happen and you have to change your program. In a real life situation, when something like that happens, you cannot trust your system anymore. So you do something drastically, shut down, take your whole hardware to a safe situation, and preferably you do that by doing nothing. So the rest of your hardware will go to safety because you might not detect your error situation. It might have corrupted your memory and there you crashed. So you want passive safety, not active safety. So what I say is exceptions don't match very well with real-time embedded systems. It's not that useful as on a desktop. Another difference, there is no operating system in the left side of the spectrum. So things like SCD cout, file system, time of day services, virtual memory, they are not there. So for code from third parties, for me to be usable on the small system, you must not use such kind of things. If you need a time of day service, don't grab out to the operating system, which is effectively some singleton hidden somewhere. Give me the opportunity to supply what you need. C++ has ample mechanisms for that in templates and things like that. Okay, halting or stopping the application doesn't mean anything for an embedded application. You cannot stop your application. Your processor will always run something. In C++, we have a very nice big standard library with things, but unfortunately, most parts of the library use things we cannot use on a small embedded system. It uses the heap, it uses exceptions, it uses floating point, it assumes an operating system with its underlying services. And for me, the worst part is often that the individual parts of the library don't document exactly what they use. Even some language features use heap for implementation, but I don't know in advance. And okay, when I could use them, they're often optimized the wrong way for me. They're optimized for average performance, not for worst case performance. So a lot of people are working on alternatives for that, but there's nothing really standard. The embedded STL and the micro STL I think it's from a gaming group, and some other people are also trying to do it. And you write fixed size containers, or you use or misuse the user written allocators for it. It can be done, but it's a lot of extra work. I would love to see a real fixed maximum size STL. When you have a large desktop system developing for a small embedded system, it's even more important to do as much things as you can at compile time versus at runtime. It's always nice to have to do things at compile time because your client's application just have to do it. But when your application runs on a very small 4-bit processor, it's even more interesting to have everything at compile time that you can. My personal favorite is to avoid all virtual things. Virtual is a runtime mechanism for dispatching. It's nice if you only know at runtime where to dispatch to, but if you know it at compile time, there are better mechanisms. You can use templates to tailor your code for the correct operations. And often people say virtual mechanism is very cheap. It's only one or two machine instructions. That's true, but it's also an optimization barrier. The compiler doesn't know what is called, so it cannot inline that part and pull in the constants and eliminate the dead branches of the ifs. And that's often much more important than the two instructors that are needed to follow the virtual function table and the virtual function pointer. That's not important. It's the optimization part that's a real problem there. Whole program optimization and devirtualization helps to some extent, but I worked a little bit with it, but it's difficult to predict when the compiler will do that. And I like to have things in my own hands, so doing it with templates is for now much better. Maybe in future, devirtualization will get better and reliable, but for now. So I prefer to use compile time mechanisms for that. And that's a bit different from what you're, what you're taught for normal desktop standard C++. RAM is scarce, RAM even more so. And one problem I have with the standard class approach with virtual functions, when you have a class with some data members and your program doesn't use them at all, they're still there. Global data that's unused is optimized away, but data members from your class are never optimized away. And in my experience, the same holds for unused virtual functions. So when you write a library and you make a nice fat library with lots of features, but your client doesn't use them, he still gets to pay for it in data members in the classes and in virtual functions. Because the compiler has no easy way of knowing which functions are called and which are not. And for the data part, I don't know. Maybe compilers are just plain lazy for that. On the other side, if you encode your things in what I prefer, static classes, that is classes that have only static functions and static member data, then everything is a static thing and the compiler can optimize the way. So then there is no, let's say, pressure on a library writer to provide only what is really needed for a specific application. Devirtualization can help, but that's only for virtual member functions. In my experience, it never helps for optimizing away unused class data. Okay, I've told what's all wrong with C++ and what's not appropriate to use on small systems. Let's tell too what is very appropriate to use on small systems. Const, const explorer, and templates are really beautiful. You can do a lot to tailor your code to generate only exactly what you want, do compile time calculations, pre-calculate and store it in ROM, don't use the ROM, avoid a piece of the code that are not important for your specific application, so you can write your library in a very generic way without imposing all that code really on the customer and the target. Rai, I love it, not for memory, but for other resources, especially for logs and other things that you have to acquire and release. I like overloading, but that's because maybe I'm lazy, but I find it difficult to find good names for a lot of things. And overload, yeah, just one name for a bunch of related things. Otherwise, I would have more sleepless nights thinking of names. And Lambda. You can use Lambda to have pieces of code and manipulate them to write, let's say, a state machine or an ADA-like rendezvous structure. It's code as first class, almost first class data member. Nice. That's what. Yeah, back. That's what C programmers have to use macros for. But we have lambdas, yes. Those were language tools. Language isn't everything. The implementation also needs to be good. You care what ends up in your small microcontroller, it must fit. So being able to exclude features I don't want is good. I don't want no exceptions. I probably don't want RTTY. If you need that, you're probably not a C++ programmer anyway, I think. If you write library code and you intend it to be also useful on very small systems, do assure that it is compilable with those flags and still works. And if you make object libraries, of course, always do that. Otherwise, your application will include the whole library with all unused functions. And of course, it would be nice if I had a min f no heap, I think like that. There are many more things that you don't want in a small system, but it's not easy to check or prevent your programmers from using it. This is a few pitches for interesting techniques that are useful in very small systems. Last year I had a talk about objects no thanks. I use no objects, that's not true. I used static classes as compile time objects. So in a sense they're objects, but they never appear in memory as objects. You can Google and find me on YouTube. XPCC library uses pretty much the same approach, developed totally independently. So statistically there must be a few tens of people more in the world who have to develop that. You can also use C++ to make your use of the low level parts of your chip much more type safe. John Hinke yesterday had a talk about that. Odin is over there. We have a lightning talk about it in the first lightning talk session. It is, yeah. His credo is safer than C and faster. I generally am quite content with being as fast as C, but he wants to be faster than C. There are not much books or literature that really concentrate on the very small systems. There's a lot about real-time systems in general, but mostly it concentrates on larger systems. This is the only book I know that really concentrates on small systems, but I'm not that fond of the book, but it's the only one, so, okay. I started with that I'd like to use other people's code in my system. And there's always the issue of licenses. For desktop systems, people always say LGPL, nice. It allows you to use your code in your work without the copyleft part, without contaminating your whole source. But if you really read the license, linking with it, is covered by the license, but you must give prominent notice with each copy of the work that the library is used in it and it's covered by your license. Okay. And my work is the flashing LED in this pencil. Why do I give this notice? And you must deal with other things like giving the people access to your code, I think, or something else. Do I write a URL here on that for it? I don't know. Let's say I make a few release greeting cards. I put it on here or something. No, not appropriate. BSD 3 clause license. Redistribution of the source must retain the above copyright. A list of conditions and follow disclaimer. Why do I put a disclaimer? Okay. That one is not a problem. But all these licenses assume that there's something in my product with which I can inform the customer, some of about screen or something. Well, a deeply small embedded system doesn't have things like that. Mid-license, the above copyright and this permission must know this shall be included in all copies or substantial portions of the software. What does it mean? Does that notice have to be in the binary parts or readable on the outside? I don't know. Maybe there's a good interpretation for it, but if you are in a company, your company lawyer must be satisfied that it's okay. Not just someone from MIT who explains it. But we have a Boost software license. So if you want to write code that's usable over a wide range of systems, do use Boost software license. It's easy and simple, and I can read it in 1 minute and be convinced that it's okay for me to use it. If you don't like Boost, use Zlib license. It's about as simple as that. But by no means, don't invent yet another license, because I have to read it and really convince myself that I can use your software. Of course, you are free to choose whatever you do, but if you want your software to be usable also on such small systems, take care of this. Okay. It's December 5th today, and in the Netherlands, that's Sinterklaas. Then you get to ask for presents, so I always ask for a present. In the workshop, I asked something about generalization of the template parameters, and I was very surprised that Michael Wong was there, and he said, we might get that. So, but this is another thing that's very dear to me. It is not because it's implementation. If I compile my code, I need to set a stack size for it. I need to reserve place in RAM for it. And then if I use a multitasking system with multiple tasks, that problem is multiplied by the number of tasks. So why can't the compiler tell me how much stack space a certain function use and all its descendant functions? Of course, you have to disallow certain things like recursion or virtual functions, but I don't want to use it anyway. So it should be doable. I think 15 years ago, I worked with Ada compilers. They could do that. You set pragma stack size that and that, and it complained when it was larger, and complained when you used any construct that violated the compiler's ability to calculate the stack size. So it should be doable. Okay, so that's my wish for this 5 December. Oh, and we Dutch eat papernoten then, so if you want to... That's in return for the wish. Okay, so summary. If you make code and you want it to be reusable across a wide spectrum, including my favorite small microcontrollers, then be predictable. Document your code in a way that describes the worst case performance, not only the average performance. Don't use the heap, don't use exceptions, probably don't use RTTY or Go program in Java or something. Guarantee a worst case performance. Avoid floating points, but that's not as hard as the other ones, but if you can avoid it, please do. Always prefer compile time things, calculations over runtime, and use an license that's compatible with using things in with you don't have a display or something like that. That's in very short points. Any managers over here? There's also a management summary that is, please don't force me to use the heap. Well, if you can remember only one sentence, remember that. Okay, so that's my talk. Any questions?
I have, let's say, some comment, an advertisement, and some help. So the comment is, if you say global allocation, you deliberately set global allocation and not global variables. And that's important to state the difference. So don't use global variables. The advertisement is, you were talking about making your number type template parameter. And CVelop actually provides a refactoring that where you can do that by extracting a template parameter from a given function or class. And the guideline, I say, if you wish for something, the best thing to make a wish come true is actually work on it. And why don't you suggest that I would recommend an attribute, not a pragma, because we can standardize attributes on, let's say, max stack attribute, or however you would spell that.
I think it's more of an implementation detail than really a language detail. But we
can standardize attributes like that to actually encourage implementers to do that. And the best thing is first implement it yourself for GCC, for example, and
then the first step.
Then propose these.
If I can find a student this bright enough to do that, I'll give it a try.
A question to your comment, actually. sorry. if you say you can transform like a const expert into a first class template parameter, like if I have a string of data, can I make that into a? I don't see how that would work. Like if I have a whole USB descriptor in string form, and I want to specialize a template based on that, I think that's what it was getting to as far as making const expert things generalized template parameter.
About context, but I was talking about regular functions where you have double, for example, float.
Yeah.
Or int, where you extract that type to become a template parameter.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
But with variadic templates, you can actually use string-like things.
Yeah. It's just terrible to type it in. Yeah.
The type. So that's a different story. That's not what I'm talking about.
That's useful too, but it's something completely different.
Yeah. And to Voder, can you maybe mention some of the techniques used to get around virtual functions? Like if I want to implement an open closed principle, I want old code to call new code. That's like a typical virtual function example.
You basically ask you for my last year's talk.
I wasn't here last year.
I don't think that I have time for that. But
you might take a look on my wiki web. There are slides on how to implement design patterns at compile time for C++, or get Andrea Alexandrescu's book on modern C++.
But my slides are simpler.
There are less jokes in
the problem. Fewer template parameters.
No more questions? Then let's close it.